obviously the Chargers headed to Tennessee, to Music City, and there was some good. There was some good. They moved the ball. There were Trey Pipkins caught a 2-point conversion. Yeah. You know what's funny? I'd been telling you about that play. I'm like, I want to see for once a lineman go up and make a grab. 5 sacks, Gilbert, after not sacking Tua Tagovailoa last week. The Chargers end up sacking the quarterback, Ryan Tannehill, 5 times. Joey Bosa in a limited role. He only played, I think, like 15 to 20 snaps, and he had 2 sacks. But then, obviously, what's been going on, what happened against Miami happened on Sunday. The Chargers had several opportunities to score at the end of the game to put the game away. They couldn't do it. They go into overtime. And the defense just couldn't keep the Titans at bay. They kick Nick Folk kicks a field goal, and the Chargers fall to 0-2. Your reaction?
Yeah. Well, the first thing is let's get into it. Brandon Staley's defense still can't figure it out down the field. I guess it's one thing, and I said it last week, Fernando. Like, I feel like Staley and the defense are running out of excuses. Like, first year, it's complex. We'll figure it out. Second year, a bunch of injuries. Year 3, you're healthy. And then maybe the excuse last week, Fernando, was like, oh, it's Tua, Tyreek Hill, Jalen Waddle. They do this to everybody. What about week 2? Ryan Tannehill, who's coming off a terrible performance against the Saints, balled out. And with 4...
incompletions only.
Oh, 4.
Look at your face.
I didn't even know about that. That's
yeah. Crazy. 4 incompletions. Ryan Tannehill,
going off from his really, really bad start to looking really, really nice against the Chargers. And that just tells you everything right there. Treylon Burks getting a big touchdown. D-Hop doing, throwing the clock back against the secondary here. So the way I just keep looking at Fernando, and I'll just keep it simple. People are mad. They're upset and they're frustrated. I get it. You want to see more from your expensive pass rushers, Khalil Mack, Joey Bosa, your expensive safety, Derwin James, and your very expensive J.C. Jackson. And I saw Vato Michael Davis was a little upset about the back and forth between him and J.C. Jackson. Can't get a rhythm.
It was everybody. They were rotating the whole secondary.
Like, you got to try something new. And even that's not working for Brandon Staley. So I know people are frustrated. I get it. And then I'm going to even point the blame at the offense. Like, at some point, when you're Justin Herbert and you're getting paid $15 million per year and the game's on the line, and you could blame the defense. It got close. It shouldn't get to – it was overtime, right? And it was, like, raining. It was a chaotic scene.
Well, no, it didn't start raining. I think it didn't start raining until the Titans got the ball.
So it was a little chaotic. Mm-hmm. But at that point, when you're in a close game and you're getting paid all this money, you can't miss throws. And that occurred. But it's not Herbert's fault. I just want to see a little more in crunch situations. But, yes, the fault is the Brandon Staley defense. And after a while, enough is enough, right?
I mean, in a sense, we have seen it from Herbert before, though, the last 2 years where he's bailed this team out. It's just for some reason, I don't know what's going on this year. The play calling at the end, I thought, was kind of was a little bit weird as well towards the end of the game. And, it's funny. I was listening to Dan Patrick, and Dan Patrick has this guy named Shane Irving on. He calls in. He's a pissed off Cowboys fan, and he's always crapping on the Cowboys. And I saw an old clip, and he's crapping on Kellen Moore. He's like, anytime we get to the end of the game, Kellen Moore just doesn't know. He confuses. He doesn't know what's going on. He calls weird stuff, and I'm like, oh, wow. I'm like, okay, maybe. And then I saw that, and I was kind of like, oh, wow. Like, 2 weeks in a row, Gilbert, last week, you were there. They decided to go for a field goal instead of, like, I mean, and I'm not trying to say that they just stalled and got the field goal and thought that was going to be it. No, their offensive play calling, once they got in the red zone, was bad. And then they decided to go for the field goal. Then the Miami Dolphins turn around. They go down the field. Tua scores. Chargers get an opportunity. Vic Fangio dials up a lot of blitzes. They get to Herbert, and that's how you end the game. This week, same thing. You get into the red zone at the end of the game. Terrible play calling. They weren't able to get into the end zone. Like, they had some creative plays. There was a play where Keenan Allen scored his – I think it was – can't remember if it was – it was a second touchdown. They acted like Mike was going to come up and take a screen, and Keenan was in both the safety and the corner – or the slot corner and the corner covering Mike. They both bit, and Keenan walked up, and he caught an easy – touchdown pass. And like, where was that creativity at the end of the game when you most needed it? So that was kind of also. And then in overtime, there was a play on third down where Mike was everybody. It looked like everybody was confused. They didn't know what the play was. Mike went into motion. He didn't know what was going on. Instead of calling a timeout, they hiked it, and then Justin Herbert had to throw the ball away, and then they punted it back to the Titans, and they never got the ball back. So, I mean, obviously, it's not what you want to see, obviously, from a high-powered team, because the Chargers are talented. Like, they have a talented team. They have playmakers everywhere. It's just, for some reason, it's not clicking. But let me get real quick to some of these, because I'm already getting yelled at. So, obviously, right here, the season is not over, but I will say this, Fernando, my man, if things go bad, it's time to clean house, start from the top. No Tommy T, no Staley, no more. None of this crap. Start fresh. I mean, yeah, I guess there's it seems like all the way from the top that people want it.
Let's get into it. And yeah, Staley looking old by the minute. And I get it. You know, I was covering the team when the fan base got sour on Anthony Lynn, and it's happening out to Brandon Staley. And I really, again, I get the frustration with the defense, and you know, Anthony Lynn's
West bringing in the positive, the power of positivity. We caught up and only have one game. Hey. Only one game behind first place in the division.
I could go off of that. Yeah, like the defense is really bad, and you know Anthony Lynn's defense under Gus Bradley was much better. I'm gonna keep it real. And is that
they were top 15, top 10?
They were modest, average, but they at least stopped the run, and maybe the secondary was a little mixed, but not this bad with this.
And defense. They would hold down the explosive plays. They wouldn't allow that to happen.
So it's gone backwards, and when you're background as defense, I get it with the frustration. But let me tell you why it's too soon to you know call for a Staley's job, and it's just it's just too premature. It's 0-2. I get it. The numbers when you look at teams who start 0-2 to make the playoffs are really slim. It's hard to do. The Bengals did it a year ago, but not every team you know could do it. And the Bengals are also 0-2 by the way this year too. The two biggest disappointing teams in the NFL, Fernando. The Chargers and the Bengals. We'll get to the Bengals on the second down. But, you know, it's too soon because it's 0-2. You have, like you mentioned, Fernando, that's why you're the go-to expert for the Chargers. You broke it down 5 minutes ago, how this is a team effort, a lot of talented players. You can still write the ship and work it out. Like, even if the defense is bad, you look at the Dolphins. The defense hasn't been that great for through two games, but the offense gets it done. I want to see more from Kellen Moore. And put it this way, Fernando, if they let go of Brandon Staley, you essentially say the season's over. After two games, you can't throw the towel after two games. And then who do you give it to, the head coaching job? Kellen Moore, who's trying to figure out the offense through two games with a new team, new players, new quarterbacks. You can't ask him to take on three phases of football when you're trying to teach the offense. So, again.
And Derek Ansley's only – he's only been in the NFL for two or three years.
He was coaching in college not too long ago, so – I took my breath. You do it too as well, a Chargers fan base. I know it's bad. Be frustrated. But to call for a firing this soon, you essentially throw away the season with so many games ago. And yes, playing the Vikings in week three, you go 0-3. You might not be making the playoffs. I get that. But we're not there yet. If they win that game 1-2, like that comment said, you're not that far behind. So you look at the playoff landscape. There's like four or five good teams in the AFC. There's two spots available. You get in the wild card, you still have a chance. So why throw in the towel right now?
The Chiefs are 1-1. The Chiefs and the Raiders are 1-1. You play the Raiders in 2 weeks. You play the Chiefs in about four or five. The Broncos are 0-2. They possibly could fall to 0-3 this weekend with they play somebody. I just can't remember who it is. I can't remember.
Last weekend or the weekend ahead?
No, this weekend coming up, this next weekend, they have a tough game. But, last weekend, Eric Bieniemy did a number on that Broncos defense.
But that's a good point. Like the Raiders and Broncos are not going to really hang around. I'm sure of that. And the Chiefs are 1-1, so it's not the end of the world here.
But I'll tell you why I think how this could change on the offensive side, on the defensive. Vaya con Dios. Hey, guys, who do you think – would you think Staley should have called a timeout, seeing the confusion on the last down? I actually do. I thought Staley should have called a timeout, kind of relax everybody, and then kind of maybe let everybody come out. But it was such a bang-bang play. Like, I mean, you know how that stuff goes. It's tough. But, yeah, somebody should have called a timeout because that was not a good sequence. But I think when we're talking about the offensive side of the football – I'm not going to make the excuse of missing Austin Eckler because obviously, yeah. I mean, you should be able to win regardless. My point is, why are you not using Josh Palmer, Quentin Johnston? Last year, Herbert spoke about it that he missed Jalen Guyton. Why? Because Jalen Guyton has speed. He can take the top off the defense. Yesterday, Darius Davis took more snaps than Quentin Johnston. Why? What?
Why use a first round pick then if you're so worried about the speed? Like, I don't get it.
Like, Quentin Johnston, I don't know what it is, but like Dan yesterday was like, oh, there we go, curl route. Oh, there we go, curl route. He's like, that's all they're bringing him in for. And it's like, you know, like if he can take the top off the defense, why aren't you bringing him in to try and help with that? And it just baffles me at times that they're not using neither one of these guys has established themselves in the first two games. Gerald Everett, I thought, had a really good game against the Jags. He had over 100 yards. They haven't really used him all that much. He had that one good play, that good catch right before halftime where he just bullied four or five different Titans. But it just kind of feels like they're going Keenan, Mike, and whoever the running back is. And it's kind of like, why don't you start integrating more weapons? Why don't you start using – I'm not saying don't use Keenan and Mike. The dude's almost had 200 yards combined and two touchdowns. So I'm not saying that, but I'm saying integrate more guys. The offensive line has been up and down. I thought they've been better, obviously, but at key situations, they allow sacks. Yesterday at the end of that game, they allowed Harold Landry got to Herbert, and it's like, on the defensive side of the football, I just don't know I don't know what has to change in that. I guess that's why everybody's so confused about it too, because they're like, well, what can change? Like, what can you do? And they say practice. It's going to be by practice. Practice, like, I just don't know if you can fix everything this quickly. And, I mean, you've seen the moments from Staley. I mean, last year against the Dolphins, they were able to do some good things against them.
That was good month of defensive football. What happened?
Exactly. So that's what I don't get. Like, I don't get is J.C. Jackson the reason why your defense can't play well? Like, then why did you bring him in? Like, I just don't understand. And then, obviously, I never trust Bill Belichick free agents just because I've always seen that wherever they go, they're not the same kind of player. But, and I'm not saying that J.C. can't be that kind of guy, but I just don't understand how you're going to be able to fix it. Even the only consistent part is the special teams. They're one of the best in the NFL. I saw some people yesterday in my comments going, oh, Ryan Fiken should take over as the head coach.
Oh, like, really?
You guys want to elevate him to head coach? I'm damn.
I thought Kellen Moore would be the option, but okay.
I know. And I've already seen names being floated around, but I'm like, I'm with you, though. Why? Like, you're not going to – the Spanos family is not going to fire them. I've been around this team for a long time. They're not going to fire these guys. They're not going to fire Staley. They'll maybe do it after the season, depending on how this ends, but they won't do it. I'd be very
surprised. That's not even a given because, as you know well, that most of any other person, they usually go 4 years for the coaching tenures, right?
Yeah. No, but – well, we'll get into that down the line, but I'm just really perplexed by everything because, like I told you, four incompletions from Ryan Tannehill and, like, DeAndre Hopkins Gilbert only had four of those catches. So he really spread the ball around. They did a lot of different things. Traylon Burks had a 70-yard catch and run on
Derrick Henry day either.
No. Derrick Henry didn't even – I mean, he had an okay day, but it was mainly – it was just the Titans picked and chose their spots. And that's how they were able to execute because they had a lot of three and outs. They had there was, I think, three series in a row where you got Kenneth Murray sack on third down, Joey Bosa sack on third down, and a Morgan Fox sack on third down. And they pick and show they were picking, they were choosing, and boom, they were able to execute. And that's how they scored their points. But man, it's just it's rough right now for this team, and especially because if you lose to Minnesota next week, then you're really going to have guys looking around being like, WTF, like, what else do we have to do? And that's not what you want. You don't want that to happen because then questions are being asked about everything, not just Brandon Staley, but other people as well. Jorge Rodriguez is asking, where's the star of the show? I know who he's talking about.
What do you
mean?
I'm right here. You
know? I know who he's talking about, but unfortunately,
Heartbreak right now, kid, you know, I'm like Shawn Michaels. I'm the showstopper here.
Right now, what time is it? It is 2:49. Right now, he is leaving school on his way to go coach to be an offensive line coach. So unfortunately, he will be here Wednesday, though. Wednesday, when the podcast podcast is released, he will be here. He has a lot to say. So you guys got to get ready to
check out What's Up Bolts.
Yeah, and check out What's Up Bolts
on YouTube, and you'll see Dan and Dago fired up as ever.
Not the boo, not the avocado.
Wow, this guy got brainwashed by Dan and Dago, man. You know, I'm gonna get back in the comments and say Dan Dago's terrible. Fernando, find a new co-host. You know,
I couldn't find anybody better than Dan. Quick,
more comments, because we actually have to get to other games. And I'll say this to let people get in the comments, vent. We want you guys to vent. If you're a big Chargers fan, you're frustrated, or you're being positive or negative, get in the comments. We'll show it. But we gotta get to the other games. But one thing, Fernando, when you mentioned the word practice, I started thinking about Brandon Staley's fired up press conference, where he's like, if you watch us in training camp, the Jaguars game is not lingering and it's not a storyline. It's just fitting for your narrative. What did went through your mind when you saw fired up Staley about that?
Dan and I kind of thought, I mean, we said it on What's Up Bolts. Dan thought it was more of like a promo like kind of thing. Like, but I was, that's what I was telling Dan. I'm like, Jorge said, nah, we still love you, Hilberto. Yeah, we do. We love Hilberto. My thing is it kind of like one of these, like you remember in the, and I know it's a bad reference. You remember in The Blind Side when Michael Orr gets, the guy comes over and kicks his helmet and the coach says, this guy plays for my team. And he starts like getting all revved up. That's what that's kind of what I thought. Maybe that's what it is. Like, he's trying to show his players, look, I still got your backs. Forget about what happened. Forget about the noise, which is what they've been trying to play for. Like, that's what they've been saying since it happened. Like, hey, let's not think about the outside noise. The Jacksonville game's over, but you've lost since Mike Williams' injury. You've lost four games in a row since that Denver game. You lost in Denver. Yeah, you lost in Jacksonville. You lost to the Dolphins, and then you lost now to the Tennessee Titans. So now the question is, well, moving forward, what, like, and then obviously our good compa Jeff Miller, he asked what's the mood in the locker room. He got set off by that one too. But I mean, I just think maybe it's something like that, like where he's trying to fire up his guys by maybe doing it via the press and everything, but I'll leave the floor to you, but that's just my opinion. I feel like maybe, or maybe he's feeling the pressure, but I think it's more of he's trying to fire up the guys a little bit.
Yeah.
But I mean, you could tell, but we know this from covering him. Brandon is a fired up guy. He does get angry. Yeah. He takes these losses personal. So I don't know what you think, but
that was going to be my point. Like, this is nothing new. Like, maybe it was a little more fired up, a little more intense, especially because now year three, a little more pressure. But I remember in his first season, after they lost to the Cowboys at home, I asked Brandon Staley, like, you know, what do you tell your team after a crushing loss like that? And he went on the speech, you know what, Gilberto, we're going to keep fighting, we're going to keep pushing. And he went off on a 10-minute thing, but like, we made like a joke about it. He said my name, my full name, Gilberto. And like, that's what he does. He wants to inspire confidence in his guys. And, you know, I know Staley is not like the biggest name in the headlines, but when you hear his press conferences and you hear him talk, he's all about these long, like, you know, speeches, inspiring confidence. And, you know, I think that's when, you know, you maybe lost it, when the guys aren't playing hard for you. They're playing in one score games. They're losing them. Eventually it gets too much and the weight, you know, becomes too much and you fall apart. But we haven't got there yet. Like, say they have a stinker in Minnesota, then maybe, okay, maybe they are losing a little bit of locker room patience with Brandon Staley. But right, when you're close, not yet, 0-2 again, calm down, take a breath, and we'll see if they'll figure it out.
You've lost by a combined 5 points. And I don't know if you saw this stat. They're the first team in NFL history to score more than 50 points in their first two games, have zero turnovers.
That's wild.
And lose and be 0-2. Like, I don't know. They have well, then he needs to give another one of those speeches to the defense because they are terrible. Yeah. Jorge's bringing that fire. First, he hypes up Dan and Dago, then he boos Hilberto, then now he's going after the defense.
I like
that. Bring it, Jorge.
As long as you're respectful comments and you're being honest,
and that's,
you're fired up.
And I think that's why we call him compas, because everybody's respectful, everybody's cool. But
we're honest, we keep it real. And
exactly. But that to me is crazy, though, that stat. Like, That stat is nuts to me. That because they've taken care of the football. They really haven't. I mean, you've had opportunities last week and this week. They have good teams. They haven't coughed up the football, and they're really taking care of it. Are you taking care of it in the expense of maybe not taking more chances down the field? That's my question, but I don't know. I don't know what you think.
I wasn't paying attention because somebody was distracting me in my text message. But you know what? You know, I'll say this: it is kind of a
much love, much love. Just want to say much love.
It is a hectic period right now, and you know, I get it. The defense needs to play better, but you know, like you mentioned, that no turnovers in two games. That's an important step, but you want to see more from your star quarterback. You want to see more from your OC, and it's only two games for the OC, Fran. So I don't know, but I'm just excited for that game in Minnesota.
You're taking the Aaron Rodgers thing. I remember. I saw that's one of the things that will always impact me. He turns to the reporter and goes, R-E-L-A, relax.
Hey, but I'm excited for that wounded animal game in week three in Minnesota because you're backed against the corner. So we'll see who comes out on top.
Somebody said, I think it's good for Staley to get pissed, snap out of being stubborn, make the changes he needs to make. First on the list, stop with the cornerback rotation. There you go. You know, it's funny, I'm not trying to say anything about, but I was at Dan's game the other day, and damn, is there a lot of coaches out in the seats? I'm like some guys, like the offensive line needs to do better. I'm like, and I said, don't say anything about the offensive line because that's where we're gonna have problems. That's my little brother. You better not be saying anything about the offensive line. So, but yeah, there's so many people. It's incredible to me how but I'm nothing against that comment, but it just made me laugh thinking that moment.
It's fine to be critical. They like
Listen
to here for now because I get where Chargers fans are coming from. This is going to be my point before I go ahead.
Right track.
It's like every single year, this is nothing new. They lose one score games. I remember that one year where Anthony and Lynn, they were like 3-11 on one score games. Like they missed field goals, or they lose in Las Vegas, or lose in Jacksonville. So I get Chargers fans being super frustrated because when this is years and years and years of losing one score games, doesn't matter the quarterback, it doesn't matter the coach, doesn't matter the defense, it's the same old crap every single year. And for that, I understand your frustration, but it's two freaking games. Let's chill out.
Half of you sounds like Dan and Dago. The other half sounds.
I want people to be honest and give fair assessments. But the full picture is it's freaking early, and it's a talented squad. When the Jets don't have Aaron Rodgers, that might be a spot in the playoffs. When the Chiefs are trying to figure it out, that's an opportunity right there. When the Bengals are on two, that's an opportunity right there. We all just assumed us experts that the division or the conference was loaded. No one has a chance. But as you know, every season is different.
One quick question Jorge was asking. In your guys' opinion, is coaching to blame? Let me finish it. The team has plenty of talent on all three sides of the football. There's teams that do more with less. Who's to blame, or is it too early to tell? I think Jorge is talking about my pick for the NFC South winners, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, who are 2-0 with Baker Mayfield.
Yeah, good call about you.
I
think about you all the time, Fran, but
it's still early. But I mean, I think it's a combination of everything, Gilbert. I mean, you can't just really point at one thing. I mean, yeah, we want to blame the coaching and everything, but I really think that it also rests on the players to step up and do their thing. I mean, like you said, Jorge, there's a lot of talent on this team. You have Khalil Mack, Joey Bosa, Tuli Pelodu. There you go. He stepped up these first two games. I'm very impressed with him. I think the Chargers found themselves a playmaker there. But you have so much talent on this team all around that stuff like this shouldn't be happening. So I don't know if it's an anomaly. I don't know if there's like a full moon or a blue moon or a red moon or whatever's going on. But it's just weird. But hey, they could snap out of it at any point. Going to Minnesota, win. Like somebody was asking me earlier, I jumped on a show or whatever, and they were like, oh, in a couple of weeks they play the Chiefs. I'm like, yeah, they'll probably win that game. Like they'll probably go into Kansas City, beat Kansas City. Then everybody's gonna be like, okay, who the hell are you? Like, what team are you? And everybody's gonna be very confused. I said they'll beat Dallas and they'll beat Kansas City, and everybody's gonna be like, okay, who are you guys? Like really? So. But yeah, I don't know. You can answer this too, Gilbert. Go ahead.
In your guys' opinion, is coaching the blame? You already read this one, right? Okay.
Yeah.
It's a little bit of both. That's why I really like your answer in the beginning of the show. And for you guys who are just joining right now, like you really broke down the poor execution in the red zone, the fourth quarter, the overtime, all that. It's a collective unit there. And again, like I keep repeating myself, I'm ready to move on to the second game. Stick around, Charger fans. Still leave comments if you're frustrated. We'll get to them. But we got to talk about the other games. And I just want to see, like, I'll just keep it simple. I just want to see if the defense still stinks next week. I just want to see Justin Herbert and Kellen Moore, you know, let loose, light it up in Minnesota and beat the Vikings, what, 34-31, and everybody could relax. Huh? I don't know.
That'd be interesting.